Hello and welcome to the Sharpening Report. I am your host, Josh Peck. Tonight, we have a very special guest for you, someone we've been trying to get on the program for quite some time, and now our schedules finally worked out that we were able to do this. So I first heard of tonight's guest when my brother Cody was living with us. He was watching the Prophecy Club out in the living room, and as I came in, he asked me if I've ever heard of him. At the time, I hadn't, so I sat down and watched the rest of the program with him, and we were both totally blown away. So Cody was the first, and not the last, but Cody was the first to suggest that I get him on the Sharpening Report, so here we are. For those who may not be familiar with our guest, Bill Schnoblin is a biblical researcher, author, and founder of With One Accord Ministries. Prior to his salvation, Bill spent 16 years as a teacher of witchcraft, spiritism, and ceremonial magic. Since leaving all that behind, God's used Bill's experience as a druidic high priest, ordained spiritist minister, and former Satanist to teach Christians the intricacies of spiritual warfare and minister to those lost in cults. So he also spent 9 years as an active member of the Freemasonic fraternity, both York and Scottish Rite, and 5 years as a devout member of the LDS Mormon Church, where he held numerous offices, including Elders Quorum President. He is he's the author of numerous books, including Lucifer Dethroned, Blood on the Doorpost, and Space Invaders, which will loosely be the main topic of tonight's show. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Bill Schnoblin to the show. Bill, how are you doing?
Real good. It's great to be here, Josh.
Well, it's great to have you. I'm really, really happy we were finally able to do this. Yeah, like I said, the first time I saw you was on the Prophecy Club, and my brother and I were blown away. It was a really good program.
Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Was that the Illuminati from Within one? Or?
Yeah.
That's lots of really... a lot of views. I'm astonished how many pirated things there are of it on YouTube. You know, it's been out. I mean, I gave that original talk in 1996, I think.
And oh, wow.
Stan Johnson, who, you know, directs the Prophecy Club, he wanted to do an updated version that they could use digital format so they could make a DVD out of it. And that, I think, was just 5 or 6 years ago. But in any event, it's certainly had its lot of views out there. So hallelujah.
Yeah, amen. Absolutely. Yeah, it's definitely interesting. The first question that I ask every new guest is about their testimony, and you have one of the most unique and extensive testimonies out there. I know it's impossible to cover it all without taking an entire show to do it, but could you give us a rundown of your testimony, the kind of life you used to lead, how mm-hmm. you got saved, and how that led to what you do today?
Well, relatively briefly, I was raised Catholic. Very, very devout, you know, Catholic family in the Midwest. This was back, you know, I was born in 1949, so this was in the 50s and early 60s. And I wanted to be a priest. I was an altar boy, you know, idyllic, Leave It to Beaver childhood. You know, the thing I think that probably got me on the wrong path is I was out trick-or-treating it 1 year. Because Catholics are big on trick-or-treating, and I had this visionary experience out walking from house to house where I looked up in the sky and I just saw, like, it was covered with demons, totally
wow.
covered with demonic entities, like bats. They kind of look like giant bats. It was like being inside of a cave, and as I stood there just totally freaked out, I was like 10 or 11 years old, you know, and I'd never seen a horror film. You know, my mother didn't read me scary stories. I mean, it was a very different culture back then than it is now. And anyhow, I didn't know what to make of it, but then these eyes of these things opened, and they were ruby red, and they just sort of burned into my soul. And I
wow.
just felt a shiver go through me. And I think at that moment, somehow or other, my young spirit was touched by the evil one. I was defiled spiritually. And that's why, you know, it's now past, but every year, you know, on September, October, we start warning people, don't let your kids be involved in Halloween. But, you know, that's a whole other conversation. So anyhow, once that happened, I started gradually being drawn into weird things. Like, you know, a nun in eighth grade gave me a copy of a book that was all about weird paranormal stuff. You know, they had these even back then. It was called Strangest of All by Frank Edwards. And it was about things like UFOs, haunted houses, you know, poltergeist, stuff like that. And I was fascinated with it. And so gradually, I mean, I got involved. I actually joined the National Investigations Committee on Aerial Phenomena, which was one of the early UFO organizations headed up by NICAP, headed up by Donald Keel, who used to be an Air Force major. And I got more and more into the UFO thing. And this was in the mid-60s. And then when I got to college, I was exposed to a professor who, and this was, again, I was going to a Catholic college. I wanted to be a priest. And so here I go to this college, and this guy is there, and he tells me that, you know, if I want to be a priest, I need to study the occult. And that just totally blew me away, because I barely even knew what the occult was. I mean, you know, I never barely heard the word, but he told me that Yahushua, Jesus Christ, was an occultist, that he'd gone to like India and studied with the gurus, and he'd gone to Tibet and sat down and studied with the lamas and the Dalai Lama or whatever. And then he'd gone to Egypt and studied with the Magi and all this stuff. And it just blew me away. But, you know, what did I know? I was like 18, 19 years old. And, you know, this guy was a priest. He had a PhD or something, you know, some kind of doctoral degree. And so I started reading up on the occult. And back then there wasn't a lot to read. I mean, nowadays you can go into like Borders or whatever, and there's just, you know, I guess Borders is out of business, but, you know, any big bookstore, and they have just hundreds of occult books. But back then there weren't that many. And I found everything I could. I read about it. I found out about witchcraft. And when I was a junior in college, I decided I wanted to be a witch, because they were presenting this, not like, you know, at that time, most people would think of a witch as being like, you know, Margaret Hamilton, the Wizard of Oz, you know, green, ugly, you know, warts, like that. And, you know, and the books I was reading said, no, this is actually, they said, like, that again, that the Lord was a witch, that he had a coven of 12, because covens have 13 members, and his 12 apostles made a coven of 13. And Mary Magdalene was his high priestess, and, you know, all of this stuff, you know. And this was, again, late 60s and early 70s. And so I thought, well, maybe this is what I'm supposed to do. So I contacted the king of the witches over in England, and I got a letter back from his wife, and she told me where to go to find somebody in America that could bring me into a coven to initiate me. And so I went and did that. And then later on, I went to Boston and got involved with they were called Alexandrian covens, because the king of the witches was named Alexanders, you know. So anyway, and he had a very large ego. And I became a high priest, ultimately. It took 2 or 3 years from 69 all the way up until 73. And I became a high priest, and we started our own covens in the Midwest and went to Milwaukee. And basically, when we showed up in Milwaukee, there were 80 people standing in line waiting for us to teach them witchcraft. And So, you know, it was definitely a big deal. And along the way, two significant things happened. The first was, before we went to Milwaukee, I went to Arkansas to study under the Grand Master Druid of North America. And I mean, I was also made a Druid high priest. So not only am I a witch high priest, I'm a Druid high priest. So I thought I was a pretty formidable guy back then. And anyway, so this guy who was actually, he was living up in the hills of Arkansas, this Grandmaster Druid. And he claimed his family had come over back in the days of Cromwell in England, you know, because Cromwell was really very much into, you know, burning witches at the stake and stuff like that. And he said that if I ever got into trouble, two things I should do. Number one, I should join the Masons. This is a Druid high priest, bigwig, you know, and he said I should become a Mason, because there I would learn more about the mysteries of Lucifer. And then later on, because I was down there for a whole summer learning under this guy, he said, if I wanted the peak Luciferian experience in my life, I should join the Mormon Church. Now, mind you, at this time, I had no idea what the Mormon Church even was. I knew they had a choir and they were out in Utah and they had a lot of wives. That's about all I knew. And of course, they really didn't by then. But, you know, that's the public perception. I never met a Mormon, nothing, you know. So I kind of filed that away and said, whatever. So I was in Milwaukee running these covens. And the other thing that happened, I joined the Masonic Lodge. But the other thing that happened is that I had the friend that brought me there ran the local occult bookstore. And he said, you know, you really ought to read this book. And he hands me a copy, a paperback edition of the Satanic Bible by Anton LaVey, which is, of course, by now it's legendary. It came out in 1966, which the Satanists say is Anno Satanas I. It's the year of the first year of Satan. They count their calendar from 1966. So anyway, and I said, well, witches don't even believe in Satan, because that's what a white witch will tell you, that I don't even believe, you know, in the devil. I just believe in the mother goddess and all this stuff, you know. Well, he said, there's really some good ideas in there. You got to read it, because I respected this guy. He was an older fellow and he was a friend. I took it and I read it and I found myself agreeing with a lot of that. So ultimately, I ended up writing the Church of Satan out in San Francisco, and first of all, I became a member. And then after a year or so, I became a second degree member, which is called, in the case of a man, it's called a warlock. So I had that. I mean, I was building up quite an occult curriculum vitae here, you know.
Right.
And anyway, let's see. And so from there, I got involved because I realized that, you know, the Church of Satan is kind of entry level. I mean, a Christian looking at it would totally freak out and say, oh my gosh, this stuff is horrible. And it is. But yet it really is not that. I mean, there's deeper levels of Satanism that's called hardcore Satanism. And I went into that. I got involved with the Order of the Black Ram. I got involved with the Brotherhood in Chicago, because at this time I was still living in Milwaukee. And basically I signed up for the whole satanic thing. I sold my soul to the devil. I ultimately became a satanic priest. And things were supposedly going to go really well, because I was supposed to get 7 years of all the power, all of the wealth, wine, women, and song, and drugs I ever wanted, and then the devil would take me to hell. Doesn't that sound like a great deal? You know, of course, we were taught in Satanism that hell is like a giant orgy with, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll for all eternity, and then heaven is this boring place where all the losers go. So that's what I thought. Because by now I was totally deceived. And because, you know, you get layer upon layer of deception. The Masonic order is satanic. They don't know it either. The Mormons, I haven't gotten into the Mormons yet. I joined them later. But anyway, so I sold my soul to the devil. And the funny thing was, is that I've maybe been in this a couple of years. And I got a check in the mail back. Back in those days, banks would send your checks back at the end of the month, canceled checks, you know. And I'd written the check every year to the Church of Satan for some years, but I got this one back, and a lady at the bank in San Francisco, where the Church of Satan does its banking, they basically had written on the envelope, she'd written on the check, "I'll be praying for you in Jesus' name." And of course, I just laughed at it. Because I thought this lady was some dumb born-again Christian, you know. And because back then I was really arrogant about it. And I thought the only, if there was a real Christian church, it had to be the Catholic Church. Because that's what Catholics are taught at least back then. When I was brought up, we were taught, you know, extra ecclesia nolus salus est. Outside the Catholic Church, there's no salvation. So if you're a Baptist, you're going to hell. Anyway, that was what they took. They've changed that now. But so anyway, I just laughed at this lady and threw it in the check file. But literally within a day or two, it was like something ran over me with a truck. I mean, I lost all my occult power. I lost my job. I was sick as a dog. And, you know, I was a very powerful warlock at this time. I mean, as you said in your introduction, I was practicing ceremonial magic. I was opening up doorways into parallel universes. I was doing all this powerful occult stuff. And I was probably one of the most powerful, if not the most powerful, ceremonial magician in the city of Milwaukee, which is a fairly good-sized city. And yet, bam, you know, I just got totally flattened. And I said, what's going on here? And so it never occurred to me that it was this lady praying for me, of course, because my ego would not allow for that. So instead, I went up to my black, I had a black temple in the attic. And it was my satanic temple. And I had a magic circle painted on the floor. And I got in the middle of that magic circle and I cried out to Lucifer. And I said, what's going on here? You know, I signed my name away. I put my name in the black book in blood, no less. And yet here I am, you know, everything in my life has just been shattered. Give me a sign. What am I supposed to do? And of course, you know what Yahushua, what Jesus says, a wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. I didn't know that scripture then, of course. And the funny thing was, is that the very afternoon I got a phone call from these two girls who were like teenage Satanists down in Chicago. And they'd heard about me and they wanted to come up on the train and see me and give me a present. And at this time I thought, well, I just lost my job. Maybe they can give me money. Maybe they can give me food. You know, what the heck, you know, I might as well melt this for all it's worth. So they show up at my door and they were all, you know, adulatory, you know, you're such a great satanic priest. And they sat at my feet and yada, yada, yada. Well, anyhow, they give me these comic books and they're Christian comic books, chick publications. You know, they were about the dangers of the occult. One was called Spellbound and the other one is called Angel of Light. And I thought, what the heck, you know? And they said, you got to read these things. They're so, they said they were Neanderthal. That was the word they used. And so this is my big present. They gave me $2.25 comic books, which I probably threw in the drawer and forgot about. Well, you know, the next day, guess what happens? I'm sitting around feeling sorry for myself, and there's a knock at the door. And I go and open the door, and guess what? It's two Mormon missionaries. And as I may have mentioned, this Grandmaster Druid guy 6 years earlier had told me if I ever got into trouble, I should join the Mormon church. Now, this is a sign. You know, these two, you know, and you've all seen Mormon missionaries, these pink cheek, clean cut, nice. They all look like they graduated from the FBI or something. You know, they all wear dark suits. And anyway, so we signed up for the Mormon church. And the funny thing was, is I discovered that they were teaching almost all the stuff that witches teach. You know, and we can explore that if you want. But, you know, and I went to the temple after a year because you have to go through. You see, the Mormon temple is not like their local meeting houses. Their meeting houses are called wards. And just to clarify this, and anybody can go to those. Most cities of any size have at least one. And I was in the Milwaukee Second Ward. Well, anyway, but the temple is only open to an elite few. Only about 1 out of 10 Mormons ever get to the temple because you have to go through the spiritual credit check. You have to go to the bishop and be interviewed, and he supposedly has, you know, the keys of spiritual discernment. And he can tell, like, if you have coffee in your home, because coffee is forbidden if you're a Mormon. Or maybe you smoke, or maybe you have pornography hidden under your bed, or whatever it might be, you know, because all those things would keep you out of the temple. Well, I got my temple recommend, which is this little card that says you're worthy to go to the temple. And so I went to the temple, and indeed, it was a highly occult experience. You walk around that. We went to the Salt Lake Temple because it's like the Vatican, you know, of temples. And the whole thing is covered with occult stuff. We did a whole book and video on this called Whited Sepulchre is the Hidden Language of the Mormon Temple, because it's got upside down pentagrams on it. It's got Masonic handshakes on it. It's got all seeing eyes on it and no cross. You will never see a cross anywhere on a Mormon building. So here I am, I'm a Mormon and I'm an elder because you have to be I was ordained an elder. And then you become an elder's quorum. Well, I became an elder's quorum president. I was working my way up the ranks and I probably would have made bishop. Excuse me, eventually. Well, anyway, what you got to realize about the Mormon church is that they really work their members if you let them. And none of their clergy get any pay except the highest level people in Salt Lake. So like the bishop of the local ward, he does all this for free. He has a secular job. And I had a secular job too. And I was, as an elders quorum president, I was basically working 30 or 40 hours a week for the Mormon church for free. And then I was also working 40 hours a week working in a retail store. That's the job I had at the time. And anyway, I was getting worn out because every night we had to go visit people, you know, and all of this. And I was gradually discovering that the Mormon church, excuse me, was not all it's cracked up to me, because I was sort of like an associate pastor. I was right under the bishop, and I was supposed to go out and visit people that were kind of falling off the end of the church. They were backslidden. That's the word we would use. Oh, and okay. They were called Jack Mormons. That's what Brigham Young called them. And I would visit these people, and most of them were very sincere, but they were discouraged because they couldn't keep all the commandments of the Mormon church, because the Mormon church has over 4,000 commandments. Mormons don't even know that. I mean, people talk about the Torah having 613 commandments. Well, the Mormons have like seven times more. And, you know, and it's like all of these people wouldn't go to church because they felt guilty, because the bishop would be up there sometimes, because a lot of times in Mormon churches, you just have members of the congregation get up and talk. But they talk, oh, I love the Mormon church and it helped me to get rid of my cigarettes, or I stopped drinking, or I stopped drinking coffee, whatever it might be. And these people are feeling all condemned because they're still smoking. And of course, you know how it is if you're a smoker, you can smell it on your clothing.
Oh, yeah.
And so bottom line is, you know, they just wandered off into the sunset. And the bishop and I would meet and talk about these people. And he actually said this. He was actually crying. He was so upset. You'll find if you hang around Mormon men, they cry easily. That's why Glenn Beck cries so much. I don't know if you knew that. Anyway, so where was I? Oh, yeah. And he said, these people, it would have been better if they hadn't joined the church, because they know what's right and they aren't doing it. I mean, if you were like a Lutheran or a Catholic and you were living up to the best you knew of that religion, you'd get to the second degree of heaven, because Mormons believe there's three levels of heaven. But right. Because, and if you want, I can talk about that. But anyway, trust me on that. And it's like kind of a, it's like you're in the bargain basement. But the Mormons, if they don't live up to all the commandments that are in the church, they're going to end up in the lowest kingdom, which is called the celestial kingdom, which is basically being stuck in a place like this planet, with all the storms and blizzards and tornadoes and earthquakes for all eternity. So it's kind of like a medium grade hell. And he said, they'd be better off if they hadn't even heard of our church. And to me, that just kind of smote me in my heart, because I thought, you know, what kind of a church is it when you, because we figured it out. 45% of the members of the Mormon church in our ward never came to church. That's kind of bad. You know, when you think about
yeah.
it. So I was studying my Bible, and I was, you know, studying the book. I actually read through the Book of Mormon 5 times, which, believe me, is an act of heroism, you know, almost to the equivalent of getting a Purple Heart. It is so boring. I mean, the Book of Mormon, I mean, I'm a well-educated guy. I have 2 master's degrees. I've read a lot of dull books in my day. But Mark Twain called the Book of Mormon chloroform in print. It is so boring. And anyway, but I read it, and I prayed about it, all this stuff, but I was just realizing there are some contradictions here. So one day, I was reading my Bible, and the Mormons use a King James Bible. You know, I tell people, hey, even a broken clock is right twice a day, and the Mormons get a few things right. So I'm reading this Bible, and this voice speaks to me and says, go to Matthew 11:28. And I don't know what Matthew, I mean, I'd finally read the Bible through from cover to cover over the course of 3 or 4 years as a Mormon, but I didn't know the Bible that well. And so I looked it up, and, you know, it was the thing where Yahushua says, come unto me, all ye that are laboring and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest, and take my yoke upon me and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Well, anyway, you know, I thought, my gosh, I'm working 40 hours a week on a job, 30 or 40 hours a week for the church. I'm ready to drop dead of exhaustion. You know, if this is easy, I'd hate to see hard.
Yeah.
So the same little voice, which I now know is the Holy Spirit, said to me, go to Matthew 23. So I went to Matthew 23, and I find, I think it's verse 2, where this is Yahushua talking to the Pharisees. And he says, you know, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and you won't lift a finger to help these people. I mean, that's a loose translation. So anyway, that really smote me too, because I felt, here I am, I'm a leader in this church. We're dumping hundreds, literally hundreds of these commandments upon these poor, sincere people. And they're not, you know, they're not able to do it. And there's not, I mean, I would try. I would pray for these people. I would lay my hands on them and give them Holy Melchizedek blessings, the priesthood, Holy Melchizedek priesthood, which is what the Mormon elders believe they have. And I would fast and pray with them, and they couldn't get any victory. They couldn't give up their cigarettes. They couldn't give up their booze or whatever it might be, because you know how Milwaukee is. It's, you know, beer city of the world. So anyway, it just really discouraged me. And then I had to move back to Dubuque for family reasons. And so I'm sitting there. I don't have a job yet because I moved. And I'm still plugged into a different ward in Dubuque, the Mormon ward in Dubuque. And I get this thing in the mail. And it was like one of these penny advertisers you get. And it advertised a prophecy seminar. And I thought, hey, this is cool. You know, I belong to a church that has a living prophet. So I can go there and I can steal some sheep. Well, I went there, all right. And the evangelist was running the show. He went after me. I never encountered a guy that knew the Bible. All the people I ever talked about were Catholics. And of course, most Catholics don't know the Bible very well. So he threw this verse at me, and I'd try and counter it. And he just fricasseed me with his sword of the Spirit. So finally, I did the one thing that Mormons do when they're confronted by a Protestant, because they don't know what else to do. And they'll say, okay, you know, where do you get the power to baptize people so they can be saved? Because the Mormons believe that either it is the Catholic Church, which has a supposed unbroken line of authority back to Peter through the popes, or you have the Mormon Church, which is started in 1830 by Joseph Smith having visitations of angels. Because they believe, the Mormons, that the Protestant churches all broke off of the Catholic churches, so they have no authority. Mm-hmm. And you can see where they might think that. So anyhow, I said that to this guy, and he cut right to the mustard. He said, you know, where do you get the idea you have to be baptized to be saved? It says in Acts 16:31, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. And that was the verse that the Holy Spirit had for me. It just, bam, you know, it went right through my magic Mormon underwear and right into my heart. And I went home that night, and I was trembling. I didn't actually cave in at that point, but my hands were really trembling on the steering wheel as I drove home. And I prayed about it, because you see, the Mormon scriptures in Doctrine and Covenants, which is one of their other scriptures besides the Bible and the Book of Mormon, they say if you're confronted with a huge spiritual issue, you need to pray and fast. And that's not a bad idea. So I prayed and I fasted, and according to the scripture, if what you're asking is true, you're supposed to get a burning in your bosom. But if it's not true, you're supposed to get a stupor on your head that will make you forget what you were even talking about. So in other words, in the Mormon Church, spiritual discernment is either heartburn or stupidity. And I didn't get either one. So I was just at a point where I thought, and then I remember, I know it was the Holy Spirit brought to mind those comic books. And I remembered in the back of those comic books, there was a thing, how to be born again. So I figured I tried every other wretched thing. I might as well try this. And so I went in the back of the closet, got the box out, got the comic out, knelt at the foot of the bed and prayed the prayer that was in the back of the book. And I got gloriously saved. That was in 1984. And then I got called into the ministry. I did my first major talk in 1986 in Salt Lake City. It was called Joseph Smith and the Temple of Doom. And then another year later, I was hired in the full-time ministry. I've been doing this ever since, basically since 1987. So that's the short version.
That's amazing. Yeah, you certainly have a powerful testimony and lots of really important areas there, which is great. And I'm glad that you brought up the book and the DVD. So if people want, you know, more information on that, they can look that up. And I mean, you have books and DVDs on a lot of different things. You have a really large catalog. One book that I wanted to talk about was Space Invaders, which deals with the UFO and fallen angel type of that type of topic. What was it that first made you want to write a book such as that?
Well, I was noticing, see, what happened was in 1988 or 89, somewhere in there, I got kind of dragged, kicking and screaming, into doing deliverances. Because people assumed, because I used to be a witch and all that, that I knew how to do deliverance. And I didn't at the time. You know, I was like a total babe in the woods. But you know how these things go. The Holy Spirit throws you into the deep end of the pool and you learn to walk on water. Hallelujah. So we were having a great deal of success. The Holy Spirit really blessed us. We were toward the end of that period. We were like spending like 40 or 50 hours a week doing deliverance on people. And it was amazing, you know, what the Holy Spirit was doing. But we started getting a few people that were not survivors of Satanism, but rather they believed they had been taken up in a flying saucer, UFO, whatever, and they had been experimented on. And of course, now this is kind of out there in the culture. I mean, there's TV shows, there's X-Files, there's, you know, whatever. But this was still a little bit outre back then. And it's the church. I mean, the church was just like, you know, we don't want to have anything to do with this. This is just like Looney Tunes stuff. These people who watch Close Encounters of the Third Kind too many times. So they didn't know what to do with them. And we realized that in the book we actually talk about this, there's not a lot of difference between someone who's gone through satanic ritual abuse in terms of the emotional trauma and the open doorways of the demonic, vis-a-vis someone who has been taken supposedly aboard a spacecraft and tied down on a table and had, you know, things stuck up their sexual orifices and other orifices too. I mean, you know, it's really quite horrific. And yeah. And I had been, because I remember I read the book Interrupted Journey back when it first came out, which I think was in the late 60s, early 70s. And that was about these two people, Betty and Barney Hill. He was like a postal worker, I think. I think they both passed away now. But anyway, and they had been stopped out on the highway in the middle of the night on a country road, and they saw this big light. And then they had lost time and then these mysterious marks all over their body. And they started having freaky nightmares. And I mean, today we'd say they had PTSD, but you know, that term wasn't around back then. So they finally went to a psychiatrist who hypnotized them, which I do not recommend, but this is what they did. And they got all these weird memories about being on a UFO and all of that. Well, so we decided we have to have a response for these people because, you know, Yahushua didn't say, oh, you know, come to me, all you that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He said, of course, UFO abductees. You know, he didn't say that. And these were hurting people. And plus, yeah, we had to find a scriptural answer. And so I, from my background, both as a student of UFOs, but also as a Satanist, I have had what, if you looked at them, and I talk about this in the book. See, it all depends on how you frame these experiences. Like, for example, the Lady of Fatima. I'm sure a lot of your listeners are familiar with that. It happened in 1917. This glowing ball of light appeared over this grotto near Fatima, Portugal. And inside of it was this woman in white. And, you know, she was seen by, I think, these three peasant children. And she started talking to them, and nobody else ever saw this, just these three kids. And she claimed to be Mary, the Immaculate Conception, and told everybody to pray the rosary, you know, all this usual Catholic yada yada stuff. Well, anyway, toward the end of this phenomenon, it got huge. I mean, people like 10, 20,000 people were coming to this little pasture in this little grotto, even though they couldn't see anything. They just see the three kids kneeling there, praying their rosaries, you know. And, well, anyhow, what happened was she, the supposed Madonna, told these children to tell the people that on a certain date she was going to give a sign. And so all these people were there, even though it was pouring rain. They're standing out, and there was like, I think, maybe 10,000 people. And all of a sudden, the clouds broke, and the rain stopped, which everybody goes, yay, you know. And then the sun appears, and the sun starts going and doing cartwheels and spinning and coming down. It appeared as though the sun was getting real close to these people, and they were freaking out. They were falling on their faces. They were screaming. They were thinking it was the end of the world. And then all of a sudden, everything went back to normal. The sun was back up in the sky. And, you know, you look at that from the eyes of a, you know, early 20th century Catholic, and you think, oh, that's a sign from heaven, you know. But if you look at it, you know, 40 years later, after Sputnik, the first satellite, I'm showing my age here, after the space program and everything, after movies like Close Encounters of the Third Kind, you begin to see that could have been a UFO. Because you will hear stories of UFOs where they open up, it's like this ball of light, and they open up, and a man or a woman who looks perfectly human, in fact, very perfectly human. I mean, they're gorgeous women, or they're incredibly handsome blonde guys. They step out of the ship clothed in light, or like, you know, silver lame or something like that. And, you know, but of course, nobody thought of that back then. So it's all about the context. And, you know, so at the time, we realized that these people were being infected with demons in the same way as someone who'd gone through a satanic ritual would be infected with demons. It was just different packaging. And the other thing we realized is that in Genesis chapter 6, there's this mysterious passage that talks about the sons of God coming down, the daughters of men, and marrying them. And then having children that were the mighty men, the men of old. And of course, the word in the Hebrew is Nephilim, which means fallen one, for these offspring. So what we came to put together, and this is what we teach, and it's what's in this book, Space Invaders, is that basically fallen angels, and I know a lot of Christians don't like this idea, that they came down in the days of Noah, Genesis 6, and seduced human women, because these fallen angels can appear to be incredibly handsome or whatever, you know, in the case of women, beautiful entities. And, you know, who wouldn't want to go to bed with somebody like that? So they were doing this to defile the DNA of the people, because they knew what Satan was told in the Garden of Eden. That, you know, out of the seed of the woman would come someone someday who would, you know, crush the head of the serpent. And they figured if they could defile the DNA of Eve's daughters, that they could prevent that from happening. That's why the Almighty sent the flood, is because all kinds of bizarre children were coming out of these unions. They were giants. They were, you know, I think there's more there. And of course, if you read the book of Enoch, like the first video teaching I ever did on UFOs is called, it was before I wrote the book Space Invaders, it was called The Enochian Chronicles. And you can still get that on our website as a DVD. And basically, I taught about how the book of Enoch expands on what's in Genesis 6. And people say, well, that's not really scripture. Well, in that day, they thought it was scripture. And Jude quotes two verses out of the book of Enoch in his epistle. So obviously Jude thought it was scripture. So what are you going to do with that? I mean, for whatever reason, the Bible ends up with certain books being in it and certain books not being in it, and that's another conversation. But anyway, the point is that Yahushua told us, as it was in the days of Noah, so will it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. And that tells us that whatever the sin was that was going on in the days of Noah will be going on right before he comes back. And what I think is happening is nowadays, you know, there aren't too many people, women, whatever, who would, if a fallen angel showed up in their bedroom looking like a lizard or whatever, they wouldn't really go for that. You know, not many women want to have sex with a giant lizard. But if you made it look like it was this science fiction thing, you know, with shiny suits and UFOs and all of this stuff, to deceive both men and women, and then allowing, either by rape or by seduction, these women to be impregnated by these fallen angelic beings, they produce what we call FADNA, fallen angel DNA. And it goes into these women, and they have children that are Nephilim. And, you know, can they even be saved? How many of these are running around? Because this has been going on at least since the 60s. We don't know about it because, see, here's the problem. In more, and we talk about this in the book. You know, I mentioned the Fatima thing. Well, 100 or 200 years before that, you have these weird stories about wee little people all over Europe, you know, the leprechauns and the dwarves and the trolls and the elves or whatever, you know, running in and stealing children. You know, the whole idea of a changeling. That the fairy folk, they came and they took our baby and they put this weird baby in its place. You know, well, that's just another way of telling this same kind of thing. So I really, and then if you study it, and I know nowadays they have all these TV shows like on the History Channel, but back when I wrote this book, this was not well known, that there are UFOs all through history. I mean, Columbus saw a UFO when he was going near, guess what, the Bermuda Triangle. I mean, the Venerable Bede, who was the historian of the early days of England, talks about, he doesn't call it a UFO, of course, he calls it some kind of a skyship. So this stuff has been going on at least for a couple thousand years, probably back to the dawn of humanity. And it's all about deception because, you know, we have been conditioned since the days of even the original Day the Earth Stood Still movie. Here's this benevolent alien who's like godlike, you know, Klaatu. Forget the thing with Keanu Reeves. I mean, I'm an old sci-fi buff, you know, and I remember seeing The Day the Earth Stood Still on television when I was a 12 or 13 year old. That was a really slick, well-made movie. And this godlike, handsome alien is going to save the Earth from our evil, warmongering ways. And this has been seeded into the group culture for at least 60 years. And so I believe they're preparing on two levels for this, what's going on. On number one, they're preparing to seed the population with this fallen angelic DNA. And number two, they're preparing us to receive a Jesus who comes down in a ball of light and steps out of a spaceship. And who's going to look just like all the pictures you see of him, you know, with the long blonde hair and the beard and really, really handsome. Even though the Bible says, you know, in Isaiah that there was nothing about him that we should desire him. There was nothing, you know, he did not look like this Bible movie they did a couple of years ago where they had this Spanish actor who was really a hunk playing Jesus.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, he didn't look like that. You know, he was, for one thing, he was Jewish. You know, so he was dark. He had dark, curly hair. You know, there's prophetic statements about what Yahushua looked like in the Song of Songs. But I'm digressing. Anyway, the point is, it's like, you know, they're going to expect people to follow an alien Christ. You know. And so anyhow, we figured out that we can approach these people that have been supposedly abducted by aliens in the same way we can approach anybody else that's been sexually traumatized or ritually traumatized. There's no difference, except maybe the prayers are a little different. But and so that's what he put together in this book, Space Invaders. Because, of course, that was the popular video game way, way, way back in the 80s. And I figured these people are really invading our space because they're taking women and men out of their beds at night and sticking things up their whatever. And, you know, if that isn't invading your space, I don't know the meaning of the word. So the other thing, too, people ask is, well, what about UFOs? Because there's a large contingent of people within the body of Messiah that say, oh, well, those are just illusions. And I tell people no, because I have been on a UFO several times. They're not illusions. They're hard and they're metal. They're, you know, just as real as this chair I'm sitting in. What people don't understand is that when an angel falls, and I've met fallen angels when I was a Satanist. In fact, I've done more than met them. I've had very blood-chilling experiences with them. But anyway, they lose all their satanic power, their angelic powers when they fall. They can't bip, bip from one end of the universe to the other at the speed of thought. They can't, you know, they don't live forever anymore. And, of course, they aren't glorious anymore. They can briefly appear to be handsome or beautiful, whatever, you know, but they actually look like humanoid lizards. That's what they look like. And if you study the UFO lore, you basically have three or four genres of aliens or species of aliens. You have the Nordics, which, because that's why they're named that, they look kind of like Scandinavian people, very blonde and, as I mentioned earlier, very, very handsome or beautiful. Then you have the Greys, which are these little, you know, teardrop-headed guys with really big eyes that stink like sulfur and walk like monkeys. And then, notice the sulfur thing, by the way, because, of course, that's, you know, hell is associated with brimstone and sulfur. Then you have the Draconians, and these are the humanoid reptiles, and they're the nasty ones. They're so-called because supposedly they come from the constellation Draco, which is the Latin word for dragon. So, anyway, the point is, this is a deception. But here's what I was going to say. Even though they have lost, these fallen angelic beings have lost all these supernatural powers, they haven't lost their intellect. They're still brilliant. They're still so brilliant they would make Einstein look like a chimp. And they have all of this knowledge of the universe at their disposal that they used to have when they were elect angels. And so they have used this to create things like, you know, wormholes, stargates, and yes, spacecraft that can travel from one planet to another. And, you know, because they can't fly anymore. They got their wings clipped, so to speak. And so they're stuck here on Earth unless they use their technology. And you know, I know you're a student of this yourself, Josh, but you probably heard out, you know, the some of the leading people, in fact, the leading guy behind the transistor, has said that an alien gave him the idea of how to do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't think a lot of your younger listeners understand how profound an impact that had on our society, because, like, in the 1950s, computers were made of vacuum tubes. And a lot of you probably don't even know what a vacuum tube is, but I remember vacuum tube radios, and I mean, they were huge. They were as big as a whole building. And the transistor enabled to get all that vacuum tube circuitry into a little thing about this big. And then from there, of course, you went to the silicon chip, and from there, now we're like light years ahead of that. But, you know, supposedly, the guy that invented the transistor, I think it was at Motorola, but I could be wrong, he actually said he got it from an alien. Now, what do you do with that? And see, here's what I believe and what I have learned both pre and post, being before Christ and after Christ, that basically these fallen angels struck a deal with our government, and I'm sure, I know for certain, with the Nazis, and maybe with the Soviet Union back in that day, that they would be able to come in and experiment on us, human beings, in return for technology. Because if you look at it, you know, I mean, in my lifetime, you know, I'm 66 years old, and I have gone from, like, you know, seeing, like, you know, TVs that were like the size of Grant's tomb, with a little tiny thing that was this big, all the way up to where now we have like iPhones and iPads and all this stuff, and we can do what we're doing here. I mean, this would have been unthinkable even 20 years ago, you know. And it brings to mind a statement that Arthur C. Clarke said. You know, he said that, you know, a sufficiently advanced culture would be indistinguishable from magic. You know, what if you were to take some Aborigine who was out in the outback and has never been into civilization, you show them an iPhone or a computer, but especially because something that small is a smartphone, they'd fall on their faces and worship you. They think you were some kind of Elohim, some kind of God. So I think that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to seed the culture. And if you look at how, I mean, somebody did a chart and they figured out that since Roswell, which was in 1947, there has been this exponential growth of electronic technology. And we just got smarter really fast. No, we got a lot of this stuff from fallen angelic beings in return for them being given the right to mess around with our people, to impregnate the women of America and other countries. And I mean, there's a whole subgenre of this, which I didn't really get into very much, about the Nazi involvement with it, about Admiral Byrd going to the South Pole and realizing that there were UFO bases run by the Nazis down there, the whole Foo Fighter thing. I mean, I can't get into everything in the book, but, you know, it's important for people not to just throw this into the bin and say, oh, this is just like a science fiction movie, because it's one more way that the devil is going to use to deceive us.
Absolutely. I totally agree. And I'm glad that you brought all of that up. It's a lot of things that we've discussed on the show, and it is really important, because the church by and large is ignoring this stuff still. I mean, there's small factions of Christianity that'll deal with it like you and I do, but most of the majority of the church, this stuff is completely for them. But, you know, like I've said on the show a lot of times, there are real people having real experiences, and they need to know how to deal with it. But I agree that the UFOs are not just apparitions. They're actually solid. My wife actually saw one, and she actually saw the being that was piloting it from the window. She wasn't abducted or anything, but she saw it. But there's definitely physicality there. It's not just an apparition or anything like that. In your book, you talk about some of the connections between UFOs and black magic. Can you go into some of those?
Well, you know, part of the thing is that in high level, that sounds funny, high level black magic, you get into the idea of hyperdimensionality, alternate universes, opening up doorways into other universes. Because, see, you know, what really is the demonic realm? The demonic realm is basically a different dimension that exists between, and it's also the angelic realm, and it's also the realm of dreams. And these all exist. That's why dreams are so strange. I mean, you could have dreams from the rock, from the Holy Spirit, that are amazing. And, you know, we read in the Bible of prophetic dreams, but there's also just dreams of, like, you know, what the heck is going on here, you know? And it just, you know, it's because and what you try to do as a ceremonial magician is learn how to travel in this realm. Now, open up dimensional doorways and then steal power from these other universes to power your own magical development. And, of course, the UFOs and this whole, you know, like this thing about, let me tell you a true story. When I was, 6 years old, I started talking to my parents about going to Dnipropetrovsk. And that's a small city in Russia. You know, that was the Soviet Union back then. Dnipropetrovsk. I don't know if I'm saying it right. But anyway, and they looked at me, what the heck? I mean, they thought I was making it up. Well, anyway, later on, after I got born again, the Holy Spirit showed me memories of me going through a Stargate to somewhere else. And the interesting thing about that is that later on, I was reading the work of another Christian who does research in this area, and he had a whole thing about how he had discovered through numerous testimonies of people he ministered to that the only Stargate in Russia was in Dnipropetrovsk. Now, what do you do with something like that? You're a little kid. You know, I know what Moscow was back then, but that was about it. And I was talking about, you know, going to Dnipropetrovsk. And, you know, that was alien technology, but it was also black magic technology because they were using this to mess with me. And I didn't even remember any of this until after I got born again and the Holy Spirit started showing me this stuff. So, you know, there's a very strong connection. I believe these things are powered. These UFOs and Stargates are powered by a form of, for lack of a better word, sorcery or black magic. Except it's what I call black science.
Yeah.
And, you know, and this goes back to something I said in the book that, you know, the stuff we see on TV, on the nightly news, on the Science or Discovery Channel or whatever, because of what we've gotten from these fallen angelic beings, we have technology that's at least 25 to 30 years ahead of these things. And I know this because I've seen it. You know, Satanists in the 19th century had telephones before Alexander Graham Bell ever came along. And in the same way, you know, I knew someone who found cloning going on at the University of Wisconsin in Milwaukee. They were actually cloning organs from the governor of the state of Wisconsin. So if he ever got in an accident, he would have a totally, you know, it would be totally genetically compatible. They could just, if he got his liver crushed or something in an automobile accident, they could just take out the liver, slap in a new liver that was identical genetically to him, and he'd be good to go. You know, no worries about, you know, it being rejected like a regular liver transplant. And that was in the 70s. And today we're still kind of wobbling around with this and saying, oh, well, maybe in 10 or 15 years. Well, no, it's already been done. Just like a lot of this black science, it's already out there. You know, and I wouldn't even, you know now what they have now, because, of course, I've been out of all this wicked stuff since the 1980s. It's been more than 30 years now that I've been saved.
Wow. Yeah, that is fascinating. And you make a lot of connections. And this is stuff that we've talked about on this show before too, but it's interesting. I think you bring out a lot of points that are unique. You have some connections between UFOs and the time of World War II and Hitler and the Vril Society. Can you tell us about that?
Well, there was a lot of and of course some of this is serviced in the popular culture, like Raiders of the Lost Ark and the Indiana Jones and the Grail movie, whatever that was called, you know. They all mentioned that Hitler was a nut about occult stuff, and he was. Hitler was involved with a group called the Vril Society, and Vril was just a term that an occult writer in the 19th century named Edward Bulwer Lytton coined. And he kind of took it from the word virile, you know, meaning manly. And it was this idea of this occult power that came from the North Country, that came from where the Elohim, the gods, live, like, you know, Odin and Thor and, you know, all of these, you know, like Valhalla. And there was also what's called the Thule Gesellschaft, the Thule Society, because in that mythology, Thule was like this fabled city way up north, like in the Arctic Circle where the Elohim lived, the gods lived. And Hitler was involved with both of these groups, and they believed that they could harness this Vril energy and use it like, I mean, in the occult they talk about you know, prana, or even in Star Wars, the Force, the idea of having this vril that you can use to control the minds of others, like a Jedi mind trick, if you will. And basically, Hitler was initiated in that. And people wonder, how could this one guy who didn't look like much, I mean, he looked like an average, I mean, if you didn't know who Hitler was, and you just saw him on the street, you wouldn't think anything of the guy. I mean, he just like a, yeah, you know, whatever, you know, not ugly, but not in any way charismatic or striking. Yet the guy took one of the most intelligent, powerful nations in Europe and wrapped them around his little finger, because Germans are not dumb. I mean, they are a very smart people. And yet he just brought out the worst of the German psyche, the superior thing, the master race thing, the Übermensch, the Superman, all this stuff. He brought it out. And he elicited it because he had this, he was like a living incarnation of black magic sorcerer's power. And I believe some of this they got from fallen angelic beings, if not all of it.
Wow.
There is one thing, I don't know if you've ever seen the book by Trevor Ravenscroft, The Spear of Destiny. You'd probably enjoy it.
Oh, right.
And anyway, he talks about, and several other people have done as well, that some of Hitler's advisors listened to him say that he said, "I have seen the Superman." And his eyes would get really big and like terrifying. And he says, "I've seen him. He's cruel. He's terrifying. And he's controlling me." You know, and it was like, okay, we're going to get out of this room right now. How do you, what do you do when your boss is like nuttier than squirrel droppings, you know, and he runs the whole country with an iron fist. But many times people testified to stuff like that, that Hitler was possessed. I mean, he was probably demon possessed to his eyeballs. And yet he was chosen by the fallen angelic being, we call them fallen celestials for short, to try and the thing that I was told, because I was involved with Nazi magic. You know, what's his name? LaVey, Anton LaVey, he actually had magical rituals that he had drawn from the works of Goebbels and Himmler and some of these people. They actually did black magic occult rituals, like Das Tierdrama. And another one is Dialektrischen Wolkenspiele. And these were like bizarre, you know, rituals that involved the use of electricity, circuitry boards, and dark black magic, and calling up and fallen angelic beings. And that's what these people were doing. You know what Wewelsburg Castle is?
Yeah, I've heard of it.
That was the temple of the SS.
And oh, wow.
Where, you know, his elite, the Death's Head SS, which was kind of like the priesthood of Nazism, they went there and they did weird rituals. And just to show you how this all cycles around, Michael Aquino, who's the head of the Temple of Set, which is the second largest satanic organization that's out in the public, he actually went to the, because this castle was bombed during World War II by the Allies, which was a very smart move on their part. And he went there and he actually did a, he called it the Wewelsburg Working, where he tried to call up the spirits that were in that castle. And he had a manifestation of a being called Iwas, who's the same being that supposedly appeared to Aleister Crowley 80 years earlier, the great famous, he's not great, but he's a famous satanic guy, magician. And anyhow, he supposedly was anointed, that is to say, Michael Aquino, to be the John the Baptist for the coming beast at that time.
Wow.
This is all involved with the holy ground, if you'll pardon the expression, of Nazism, because that place, that castle, was like the most central, evil, dark hub of all of the Nazi empire.
Wow. You said, you mentioned earlier that you had abduction experiences and have seen UFOs. Could you tell us about that?
Well, let's see. I mean, the one that I had in Milwaukee was one of the less strange ones. And basically, I was a witch at this time, and it was winter. It was January, which in that part of the country is bitter cold. And my spirit guides, see, I had spirit guides. I was a medium, as you mentioned. I was an ordained spiritualist minister, and I was a medium. So these demons, I thought they were ascended masters, but these demons spoke through me. And they said, we want you to get in your car at whatever it was, 11:30 at night. You know, it was probably 20 below zero out there, but get in your car and drive out to the Menominee River Parkway and get out of your car at X and Y place and walk down and we will meet with you. Oh boy, I'm going to meet with the Ascended Masters, you know, big woo. Yeah. I mean, yeah, right. I was deceived to my toenails at this point. So anyhow, I go, I park my car. Of course, I'm dressed very warmly. I walk down the hill. And I remember, clear as a bell, there were these huge pine trees. And it was snowy. And all of a sudden, I see this thing coming out of the sky. And light. And the light just beams down upon me. And that's it. I'm out. And the next thing I know, I'm standing in this boardroom, like something you'd see in some law office or something. You know, this is so weird. I mean, it's like wood paneling and, you know, this big high desk, kind of like you'd see it like the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. There were all these beings sitting behind this. I think there was 8 of them, if I remember right. And every one of them was a different kind of alien. I mean, and some of them looked totally bizarre. And this is before, you know, Star Wars came out. And what was really weird is that the guy that was sitting in the middle looked a little bit like Darth Vader. I mean, it's entirely in black. And he had this like samurai helmet on his head. And he had a sort of mask, but not really. I mean, it was not really that close, but it was when I saw the movie and I saw, you know, the first scene in Star Wars where he comes walking into the rebel ship at the start of the movie. And it was like, you know, it was like, I felt like somebody was walking on my grave.
Yeah.
And they
asked
me all these questions about masonry. These are aliens and asking me, it's like they're quizzing me upon masonry. And at the end they said, you have not learned your lesson well enough. So we're sending you back down there for another 10 years. And so the next thing I know, I'm flat on my face laying in a snowdrift in the Menominee River Parkway. It's like they just dumped me out. And now that's not typical, but I mean, that's a particularly weird one. And I know when I went out to the temple in Salt Lake City, because there's an integral link between the Mormon church and the UFO phenomena. And, you know, all the way back to Joseph Smith's first vision, which if you look at it in a different way, as I was saying earlier, it sounds like a UFO encounter.
Yeah.
But anyway, when we drove all the way through to get to Salt Lake, because they didn't have money to spend in a hotel. And so we just drove straight through. And as we got into Western Wyoming, I think it was, we're in the middle of the night, and we started seeing all of these UFOs, and they were like buzzing us. They weren't normal aircraft, because we stopped the car and looked, and they would stop. And then when we started the car, they'd follow us. And they looked a lot like the little things that were in the Close Encounters of the Third Kind, those little tiny things that the police cars were chasing and stuff like that. But let me think, this would have been after Close Encounters, because this was in 1981. But still, you know, it was totally weird. And I mean, over the years, I've probably seen 100 UFOs in various, some of them just nothing, you know, extraordinary. But the one that probably is the most intriguing is when I was down in the Grandmaster Druid's mountaintop lair studying with him along with 5 or 6 other people. We'd sit on the mountaintop at night on this picnic table, and he'd give us a lecture. And if it was a clear night, every night there'd be a UFO hovering over the mountaintop. Every night.
And wow.
It was so close you could literally look up, and you mentioned that, was it your wife that they actually saw somebody in the window of it? You could actually see people in the window. It was like, it looked like the gondola of a blimp.
Wow.
It was like a cigar-shaped thing, but it wasn't, because you could see the stars right above it, so there was no, like, large dirigible thing over it. And it was totally silent, and it would hover there for the entire class, and as soon as he was done talking, it would just silently go away.
Wow. Yeah, it's crazy. And with, cause that's similar to my wife's, experience. The craft that she saw, she said it was smaller. It wasn't, the cigar shape, but it was like the dish shape, but it was smaller. And she actually saw the being inside before it took off. She was, I think she said she was about 14, 12 or 14, somewhere around there when she saw that. And, she's seen a couple more since then, but that was the most prominent one. And of course she had a lot of questions, now, thanks be to God, we know what they are, but, mm-hmm. I mean, there are a lot of people that are seeing these things and they don't know how to interpret it. Don't know, you know, what to do about it. And, if somebody sees a UFO, or if they're visited, or if there's an attempted abduction that's taking place, what would you suggest somebody do if they find themselves, you know, if anyone listening or watching this finds themselves in a situation like that?
Well, first of all, we recommend obviously get saved. I mean, if you're born again, that's step one. But beyond that, we really recommend people cleaning out their homes of anything that might be an occult doorway. Like if you have a little statue of Buddha that you got when you visited Chinatown, get rid of it. If you've got, you know, your grandfather's fez from being a Shriner and a Freemason, get rid of it. Things like that always make it easier for evil things to get into your home. So make sure there's nothing, and both on our website and in our book, Blood on the Doorpost, we have exhaustive lists, as exhaustive as they can be, of things that might be an open doorway in your home. Then you need also to consecrate your house unto the Lord Yahushua, declare that he is the sovereign ruler of your home, and that the devil has no place there. The other thing we recommend people doing is remit the sin of the shedding of innocent blood over the land. That's out of the book of Deuteronomy. And basically, you just realize that if innocent blood has been shed over the place where your home or your apartment or whatever is sitting, it's cursed. That land is cursed. And even if you had nothing to do with it, you can still be negatively impacted by that curse. And so we recommend people just applying the blood. And again, we have prayers. People can go to our website, which I don't know if we mentioned that or not, but it's withoneaccord.org. And we have there free prayers they can download for how to bless your home, how to remit the sin of the shedding of innocent blood over the land. Another thing that's really good is to put mezuzot on your door frames, because the Bible says in Deuteronomy 6 that we are to put the word of Yahuwah on the doorposts of our house, and that really stops a lot of stuff. And if you don't know how to do it, we have some instructions on that on our website. And if push comes to shove, just take what I tell people is just take a copy. It should be the King James Bible. Make a photocopy of like Deuteronomy 6 verse 4 through 9, roll it up, put some duct tape on it, and slap it to the doorpost of your house. I mean, that's down and dirty, but it works.
Yeah.
And pray over it. And of course, the problem is you've got to believe in the Bible. It's not like a magical talisman. You have to be a faithful person and read your Bible, not just stick it on the doorpost. But anyway, okay, so if you've done all that, and these things are still getting in and they're still bothering you, first of all, if you wake up and you, like if you have sleep paralysis or if you see something at the foot of your bed or whatever, just say, Yahuwah rebuke you. I reject you in Yahushua's name. I command you to leave me alone and don't return. You know, get out of here in Yahushua's name, or, you know, we just say Yahushua because that's his real name. You know, his name is Jesus. really, although it doesn't hurt if you use that name, but I think the Yahushua is better. And that usually gets rid of them. And the other thing I tell, especially women, because more women than men get this habit, is that if all else fails, read the directions. And what I mean by that is that in Paul, and I think it's 1 Corinthians, he talks about how women need to cover their heads for the sake of the angels.
Yeah.
And we have had men. Now, a lot of people interpret, oh, well, that means a woman should have a headship covering. You know, she should be underneath her husband or her father or her pastor, or blah, blah, blah. Well, you know, that's one way of looking at it. But let's look at it, you know, plain and simple. You know,
yeah,
fallen angels love human women, and they find the women's hair incredibly seductive. And so if you're having, like I told this one crowd a few years ago, if you're having a fallen angel show up at the front of your bed with candy and flowers, here's what you do. Cover your head with a handkerchief or a scarf. I mean, and everyone who's ever done that to them, we're being bedeviled by fallen angels, they stop coming.
Wow.
They'd already done all the other stuff, but they hadn't done that. And think about it. If you look, and I don't know how much you're into history, but in the history, I mean, all through, whether it was Europe or to this day in the Middle East, of course, women have always covered their heads. Why is that? I mean, women, if you watch, like, you know, a Jane Austen movie that's set in the early 1800s, you'll see all the women go to bed at night with a nightcap. Every single woman wore one of those to bed at night. That was just how it was done. And you'd ask them, why do you do it? And it's like, you know, Tevye and Fiddler on the Roof, you know, why do you wear these little things on your clothes? They don't know, but it's tradition. Well, it's the same thing with this. They don't know why they do it, but somewhere in the distant past, one of their matriarchal ancestors figured out that if I cover my head at night when I go to bed, fallen angels and demons aren't going to mess with me.
Yeah.
And so that's basically, now rarely, and I have to say this, rarely you will find stories of people who have done all that stuff and they still get abducted. Why? I don't know. That's something we're studying through. And there's other people, I mean, there's Alien Resistance, another ministry that is more totally focused on that. I think Joe Jordan runs that. I think he's in Florida, but I think he moved. I don't know. Anyway, look up Alien Resistance. There's several ministries that do this, but the trouble is, again, the harvest is great, but the laborers are few. And you know, we're just overwhelmed with people needing help. But basically, if you're a Christian and you use the name of Yahushua or Jesus, that will usually stop these things. But you got to realize, especially these gray things, you know, the gray aliens, because I believe they are kind of like biological robots. They've been created by the fallen angels. Why? Because they're technology.
Yeah, me too.
They're not spiritual. And so therefore their heart, just like you can't, if someone fires a gun at you, you can't say, you know, in Jesus' name, stop the bullet. It might work, but it might not. You know, I'm not saying that Yahushua isn't able to stop a bullet. Obviously, he is. But I'd also duck. In the same way, the grays are a little bit harder to deal with because they're like machinery. They're like biological machines. They're not like a fallen angel.
Well, thank you for sharing that. If people want to find out more about you or order your books and DVDs, where can they go?
Well, we have a website that I mentioned earlier. It's withoneaccord.org, and we have a tremendous amount of free stuff there. We have 8 books that I've written and countless. I mean, I probably by now it's 20 or 30 or 40 DVDs, teachings on all these subjects and others as well, Bible prophecy and things like that. And that would be the basic source that you would come to. And you could also write us if you prefer to not deal with the internet. It's with One Accord Ministries, and it is 3500 Dodge Street, suite number 205, number 290 in Dubuque, Iowa. And that's 52003.
Fantastic. And I highly recommend people check out your stuff. It's there's a lot of really important information. If you had to wrap up this entire interview in a final thought, what would you want most for the audience to take away from this episode?
Well, I mean, we've talked about a lot of really strange things, and the universe is far stranger than any of us can even imagine. But when you see all of these strange things going on, I just want to remind people that, you know, Yahushua said, when you see all these things, lift up your heads, for your redemption draws nigh. And that's the thing to bear in mind. The weirder the world gets, all it means is that you're getting closer and closer to the second advent of Messiah. And the important thing is that things are going to get bizarre. There's going to be, I mean, this stuff that's going on, like with ISIS in the Middle East, is just the beginning. And you need to be buckled in spiritually. You need to know for sure who your Lord is. Is it the adversary? Is it Satan? Or is it Yahushua the Messiah? And, you know, because if you aren't part of the solution, you're part of the problem. And it would be so easy in this time and day for people that aren't born again to be taken over by the demonic, whether it's these fallen angels and UFOs, or whether it's just garden variety of demons of whatever stripe, you know, whether they're, you know, demons that make people drink or demons that make people do drugs or whatever it might be. The point is, you have no defense without Christ. No defense. And so you need to come to him in simple faith and ask him to be the master of your life and save your soul. That's the given part of it. And then I would just say that, you know, if you are saved, you need to really press into Messiah, pray more, fast more, read your Bible more, spend more time with him and less time with the world. Because you know what they say, you know, the thing that you love is the thing you spend your time with. And unfortunately, I know a lot of people spend more time on Twitter and Facebook than they do in their Bible. So, and I mean, I thank the Almighty that we have these internet tools, but don't let them run your life. Let him run your life. And then he will keep you safe, you know, when all these weird things start happening. So that, I guess, would be what I would leave everybody with.
Bill, I can't thank you enough for coming on the show. This has been such a fantastic discussion, and we're definitely going to have to do this again sometime. It's been a blast, and I can't thank you enough for coming on.
Well, that's fine. We'll do it again, I'm sure. Okay, shalom.
Absolutely. All right, well, hang on the line, and I'll close us out here. That again was Bill Schnoblin, author of Space Invaders, as well as many more fantastic books, checks, and DVDs. Check out the links below in the show description for those. I highly suggest all of his materials. There's a wealth of information that we can use for today and for the dark times that are ahead. If you would like to find more episodes of The Sharpening Report, you can do so at ministudyministry.com and my YouTube channel, youtube.com/Josh Peck Disclosure. Make sure to subscribe and share. Also, if you care to help support Mini Study Ministry, you can do so at ministudyministry.com. Your donations go to the everyday running of Mini Study Ministry and help bring you more episodes of The Sharpening Report, as well as more books and other materials. And as I say in every episode, I'll say again, please only donate if you feel God leading you to. If you're not sure, or if you don't feel led, you can always pray for us. We can always use more prayer. We're not 501c3, not that we're against it, we're just not. So your donations are not tax deductible. And I'm never going to be the kind of person that will promise extra blessings from God or a miraculous tenfold return on your money or anything like that. We're not in the business of making it. What I can promise, be it prayer or financial, is greatly appreciated. It keeps us going, and it's the only reason we're able to continue doing what we do. So I want to thank you all for joining us tonight on The Sharpening Report. I am your host, Josh Peck, and as always, take care and God bless.